Thank you so much for that very kind introduction. Dr. Binoy Joseph, Principal, Rajgiri College of Social Sciences. Reverend Francis Sebastian, CMI and Faculty Member and Coordinator. Dr. Manoj Matthew, Director of Corporate Relations. Alumni and entrepreneurs gathered here. Ladies and gentlemen, students, despite the compulsory attendance, thank you for being here. And thanks for that tip, by the way. Ladies and gentlemen, let me begin with congratulating the Office of Corporate Relations for organizing this alumni meet around an extremely relevant and useful topic for all of us, not just for you, but for the country as a whole. Every decade has a few milestone magnets that define it. This decade is indeed the decade of startups. The startup ecosystem has attracted thousands of young, talented brains all over the world, and the good news is that India has also joined the race. Software service companies brought about the first change in the early 2000s when the demand for human resource in the IT sector was huge. But at that time, the dream of opening up a startup was only for a rare breed of brave entrepreneurs. The change really occurred when recession hit the world in 2008-09. I was at that time a doctoral fellow in IIM Bangalore, and in seminars and workshops, the message was that the impact on Indian economy was minimal, not drastic. But the pressure felt by fresh engineering graduates and management graduates who had a heavy burden of student loan on their shoulders but no real job offers, that was very real to me. So that became the spur for people to think different. India is a young country with over 60% of the population in the age group of 25 to 35 years. Millennial Indians are strong believers in pursuing their own dreams rather than the safety of a regular paycheck. And the cue came from Silicon Valley with its startup culture. It is only possible in the IT sector for someone to come up with a brilliant new software solution or an app and make a viable business proposition out of it. The idea instantly caught the imagination of the young Indian. Moreover, the growth in technology and the fast-growing demand for smartphones helped fuel the idea of technology startups. And the age of the startup Indian was born. The Central Department of Science and Technology set up India's first startup village at Kochi. Coincidentally, this was the hub. The beginning was here. As the first PPP model incubator in 2012. It won the central government's appreciation for being the best technology business incubator after it produced hundreds of startups and created a new model for student and youth entrepreneurship. Kerala Technical University designed policies for university student entrepreneurship. Experiments such as student entrepreneurship policy, which allows 4% grace marks and 20% attendance waiver for student entrepreneurs, encouraged over 200 student teams to create startups. In addition to the technology startup policy in 2014, the state also earmarked 1% of its budget for youth entrepreneurship. Another significant initiative was the setting up of startup boot camps in around 100 engineering colleges. Today, the success of Startup India, with 40 plus accelerators, 30 plus angel investors, 6 to 8 early stage funds, 10 to 15 later stage funds, besides various forums and communities that support the startups, all stand testimony for the prevalence of the startup culture in the country as a whole. According to the NASSCOM report of 2017, India is home to 5,000 tech startups and is the third largest ecosystem after USA and UK. Now it is incumbent on the government to put in place an ecosystem that fosters and sustains entrepreneurship in the country to create durable human and industrial assets. Some initiatives of the central government and the state governments include, you get a lot of information on the net, I'm just summarizing them here. Single window clearance even with a mobile application, about rupees 10,000 crore funding, 80% reduction in patent registration fee, modified and more friendly bankruptcy code to ensure 90-day exit window, freedom from inspections, capital gains tax and tax and profits for 3 years, self-certification compliance, innovation hub under Atal Innovation Mission, innovation program starting with 5 lakh schools to target 10 lakh children, new schemes to provide IPR protection to startups and new firms, stand India across the world as a startup hub. However, initiatives and programs of the government are only one aspect of nurturing a vibrant startup ecosystem. When we refer to the ecosystem, it includes the holistic participation of all stakeholders, government, venture capitalists, startup entrepreneurs, institutions, and markets. While it is encouraging to see that India stands abreast with other developing countries, are we really leading the global startup ecosystem or playing a major role in it? To my mind, the more challenging task is to create a culture that accepts and nourishes entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship and startups are only a recent phenomenon in the country. It is only in the last decade and a half that people in the country have moved from being job seekers to job creators. Doing a startup is tough, and every country sees more failures than successes. An entrepreneur needs to be prepared to face failures and hardship. However, culturally, we are not groomed to fail, and failure is frowned upon. It is regarded as the end of the road, not a bump in the road. This tendency stalls many promising entrepreneurial careers and perhaps stops many from even daring to try in the first place. Given that the vast majority of startups fail, Indian business culture must take a good hard look at its tolerance for founders' missteps and encourage the knowledge gained from failure to be applied to future success. Entrepreneurship thrives on celebration, and a society that fails to appreciate business failures stifles innovation and creativity. A startup failing has to be okay, as failures often teach an entrepreneur what to do and what not to do. It is time that the Indian business culture begins to encourage information gained from mistakes to be applied to future successes. Given that the vast majority of startup journeys end even before taking flight, a business environment must be cultivated wherein limited funding and the lack of a proven business model should not act as constraints. Do any of you remember that famous scene from Jerry Maguire? Show me the money. Okay, this was probably a few years before your time. It shows, for me, it kind of crystallized the whole attitude of conservatism in investment, which is what we see in India today. Investment culture is conservative. In the US, startups can get funding even on the basis of a very strong concept without revenue or even a set business model. Companies have the opportunity to prove their value propositions and test products extensively before releasing them to the market. In India, access to capital is is limited, causing startups to focus on monetization, revenue, and lean operations from the outset. Startups are usually funded only after they have a working product and a proven business model with revenue. In other words, Indian investors will only give you money if you have already shown that you can make money for them. But this approach can result in missed opportunities. The learnings that benefit startups that are willing to sacrifice revenue in their early phases in order to focus on refining the product and gaining organic product growth. Without that cushion of funding, it's also much tougher for Indian startups to pivot, leaving many companies to flounder. Capital and access to capital has been a perennial problem for startups. Of late, angel investors, venture capitalists, and private equity have brought some extent of succor, but a large number of startups still grapple to raise funds from the institutional setup. Funding challenge is not merely restricted to the seed rounds, but also to the critical Series A and B rounds. For a startup looking to scale, it is still very hard to raise rounds to scale, as the number of investors that write down larger checks in India are too few. Next, India is still an employer's market. In an atmosphere of fierce competition, personnel forego perks or recognition simply to hang on to their paychecks. Workplace culture tends towards micromanagement rather than employee autonomy, achieving results but sacrificing employee satisfaction due to the added pressure. Encouraging creativity, pursuing innovations even at the cost of lost time, techniques that Google has employed so successfully, is not yet part of the Indian ethos. Young founders too are very eager to know about funding, accounting, marketing, and sales. Very few pay attention to innovation, relevance, skill building, community integration, and sustainability. If the majority of startups' concerns revolve around funding and analyzing the market size, how can they differ from conventional businesses? Moving on, the economy has been in a flux, and in an uncertain economy, where one is not sure about demand, it is particularly difficult for a startup to make correct estimates on the number of employees needed. This is a lesser problem where the larger issue is about finding skilled manpower. India's skilling need is so great that the National Skill Development Corporation has been mandated to skill 150 million Indians by 2022. For a startup, it is particularly difficult to attract and hire talent and skilled workers. A startup often cannot match the salaries drawn at larger companies, nor is a job at a startup seen as a steady one. This means startups face severe hiring challenges, and at times they have to settle for the second best. Next, for a startup, it is very important to have mentors who have been through a similar process of starting or having business experience. A great mentor's valuable inputs can often make the difference between success and failure. However, there is no formal mechanism to mentor startups in the country. Mentoring happens on an ad hoc basis. A startup that has raised funds can count on investors for some sort of mentoring, but honest, unbiased, good business mentors are few and far between. So, these are some of the challenges that Indian startups face. But it is not entirely a bleak picture. India enjoys some significant advantages which we need to recognize. First, demographic dividend. India, with 356 million 10 to 24 year olds, has the largest concentration of youth population. This augurs